Hello, Samuel Andreev here. I'm a composer, and I'm going to be talking to you today about the Hungarian composer György Kurtág and his 1988 string quartet, Officium Breve in Memoriam Andrei Cervenski, Opus. So I'm going to start things off by presenting an overview of the life and work of György Kurtág, who is certainly the most important living Hungarian composer. And I'm going to zero in on this particular work, which is very typical and emblematic of the composer's work. Finally, I'm going to go into a little bit more analytical detail towards the end of the video. But first of all, why bother listening to this piece? The first thing I would say is that if from a historical point of view, Kurtág is one of the last remaining links to an entire generation of composers that revolutionized music in the post-war period. So these are composers that were born in the 1920s and came of age in the immediate post-war period. So Kurtág, along with Betsy Jolas, who is a French-American composer, are really the last remaining survivors of that generation. We have other composers whose names are also probably quite well known, people like Boulez, Stockhausen, Bruno Maderna from Italy, Luigi Nono as well, György Ligeti, who is another Hungarian who is very, very well known. So this whole generation of composers basically revolutionized music in the post-war period. They were starting from the point of view that following the enormous cataclysms of the first part of the 20th century, music somehow had to be rethought, and they were committed to innovation and progress. These were all committed modernists. Kurtág is, in a certain sense, an odd one out in this bunch of composers because, first of all, he started his public international career considerably later than a lot of his colleagues. And this was to a large extent due to his geographical situation, the fact that he was living in what was essentially a communist dictatorship in Hungary. Kurtág's music is intensely expressive, and it often makes use of formal strategies that are incredibly condensed. So he's very fond of writing works that are basically sets of miniatures. And when I say miniatures, they are really, really short. So for example, the work we're about to look at is made up of 15 movements, and most of these movements are less than a minute long. So some of the individual movements in this piece might be only four bars. So he's very, very concerned, first of all, with not wasting the listener's time, and also distilling and boiling down his ideas to the absolute essence. And one of the interesting side effects of composing in this way is that it does away entirely with the idea of development. So essentially, in Kurtág, what you have is a series of moments. And these moments are intensely charged. They're expressively charged, they're historically charged, and he's a composer who's obsessed with the idea of putting as much as he possibly can into a small space. Not necessarily through complexity or through writing very, very dense textures in his work, because that's usually not the case, but rather through having a very rich and extended web of intensely personal associations in all of his pieces. Kurtág is very, very tightly connected to history. He's completely steeped in it. He's obsessed with the great musical figures of the past, and he often renders homage to them in his works. But at the same time, in keeping with the other members of his generation, he's also very preoccupied with the notion of innovation. So his music is extremely personal, and it really sounds like no other music I've ever heard. But at the same time, it draws on historical sources. So it's music that pulls you forward into new worlds, into entirely new sonic experiences. But at the same time, you're not left adrift completely because the music is so strongly tied to tradition and to things that are, in some level, familiar. Now, Opus 28 is, I think, an ideal introduction to the work of Kurtág because, first of all, it is rather typical in the sense that it is a work that is made up of a series of very, very short movements. It's extremely expressive. It's got an amazing surface beauty. Even if you don't have the slightest idea what's actually going on in this piece or how it's written or what the composer is trying to do. Just listening to the sheer surface beauty of it is enough, and you'll get an enormous amount out of it. So in case you're not familiar with Kurtág and his life and career, I'm going to start off with a brief biographical sketch. Kurtág occupies a rather singular historical position. To bring that into focus, I'd like to compare him briefly with the composer György Ligeti, another Hungarian. They were almost exact contemporaries. Ligeti was born in 1923, so 3 years earlier than Kurtág. And it's very instructive and interesting to see the differences between these two composers. Ligeti was able to escape the communist regime in Hungary in 1956 and left for Austria. And his contact with the West was extremely significant in terms of him being able to develop himself artistically and also to become much better known internationally. And then the other significant event that happened with Ligeti was that his music was used by Stanley Kubrick for the film 2001: A Space Odyssey, and that catapulted him very suddenly to international fame and success. And so Ligeti's music became very, very widely known to a massive audience rather quickly, whereas Kurtág, for his part, remained in Hungary and worked as a chamber music teacher. And he was known as an extremely exacting teacher with incredibly high standards. He would spend an enormous amount of time on what could seem like very small details, but always in the goal of producing a transcendent and incredibly intense and powerful performance. But the point about all this is that Kurtág was basically forced to establish his aesthetic and his work in relative isolation, and he had actually comparatively little success internationally until the 1980s. And that really started to change in 1981 when the Paris-based Ensemble Intercontemporain, which is the sort of premier French ensemble for contemporary music, conducted and led by Pierre Boulez, commissioned a piece from him. And the resulting piece, which was called Message de Feu Demoiselle Hervé Trousseauva for soprano and chamber orchestra, was a huge success and certainly generated a lot of further opportunities for Kurtág. And it's really after the 1980s that he started to get a lot more international attention, a lot more commissions, a lot more performances outside of Hungary. Now, one side effect of his incredibly high artistic standards is that when you look at his catalog, you see very quickly that he's actually written comparatively little, particularly considering the fact that he is someone who's had a creative career spanning 7 decades. I'll just add one more thing, which is that Kurtág is also an absolutely wonderful performer, and he often performs as part of a piano duo with his wife, Marta. And they perform transcriptions of classical works such as Bach's cantata Actus Tragicus, which is a work that I have analyzed actually on my YouTube channel. So if you're interested in that piece, an amazing piece, then you can check out that video. And they've also made many, many performances of Kurtág's piece for two pianos, Játékok. It's a series of very, very short piano pieces, a long series, and the title translates as Games. So I'd like to talk about Officium Breve, this Opus 28 string quartet. Now, I mentioned earlier that it is very emblematic and very typical of Kurtág's work, and that's for a number of reasons, so I'm going to talk about those very briefly. So, the first thing about this piece is that it is a sort of double homage to two figures that have been very prominent in Kurtág's life, certainly as a musician, but that have also influenced his work in a variety of ways. And so the work is actually a sort of incredibly interconnected web of references, not only to these two figures, but also to a series of other Hungarian musicians. And so what's actually going on in this quartet is that it is essentially an homage. It's also a requiem. It's paying homage to the memory of these great musicians, and also to the memory of a series of friends of Kurtág who have passed away. So what we really have here is a sort of a very, very interesting and very sophisticated melding together of influences. So we have, on the one hand, the influence of the Hungarian composer Andrzej Cervánszky. So Cervánszky was a composer who was born in 1911, died in 1977, and similarly to Ligeti and Kurtág, he started off his career under an intense influence of the music of Bartók and of Hungarian folk music in general. And you can certainly hear that in his earlier works. And then, as he got a little bit older, he became very strongly influenced by the work of the Austrian composer Anton von Webern. So, after the 1960s, Stravinsky's music starts to go off on another direction, but still, of course, very much in keeping with his own personal aesthetic. So in works such as the Six Pieces for Orchestra, which, by the way, is an absolutely remarkable piece, you have this incredible refinement in the orchestration and just incredible sonic ingenuity, but you also have a very clear influence from Hungarian music. And but also, probably more importantly, you have also the influence of Anton Webern, this sort of concentration, this kind of technical ingenuity that you get in this music. But the work that Kurtág specifically refers to in Officium Breve is Serenade for String Orchestra, and that dates from 1947, 1948. Very significant. The reason that, that date is significant is because all of the works that Kurtág is referring to here basically were written in the 1940s. That is the period in which he's a student. That is the period in which he's coming of age artistically, and he's starting to formulate his own aesthetic language. And so really this work is biographical in the sense that we're zeroing in on works that were written in the 1940s and just sort of Kurtág's own personal relationship with these works that have helped to define him creatively. So the second reference that is central in this work is, of course, to Anton von Webern. So Webern wrote a piece at the end of his life in 1943, the Second Cantata. And the Second Cantata is the last piece he ever wrote. And so Kurtág in the Officium Breve is rendering homage to the final movement of this work. So before we go on, I'll just point out that the title Officium Breve simply means a short service. And in this case, it is specifically a funereal service. It's a requiem. This is a piece that is rendering homage to a series of deceased colleagues that have meant a lot to Kurtág. So I have to start off by talking a little bit about Anton Webern, because he is absolutely central to the conception of this work. So Anton von Webern was an enormously influential Austrian composer, born in 1883 and died in 1945. And Webern was a member of the so-called Second Viennese School, whose members also included Alban Berg and Arnold Schönberg. And it's no exaggeration to say that Webern had an enormous influence on the entire direction of post-war music. He was an emblematic figure, a sort of figurehead, if you like, of musical modernism and sort of progressive aesthetics. Webern had a rather tragic life, and actually the reason that I've chosen this photo, because it's certainly not a very flattering image, but I wanted to choose this photograph because it is so charged with tragedy and with historical significance. So Webern was accidentally killed by an American soldier in September 1945, and this photograph was taken in the summer of 1945, so just a few months beforehand. And in, I believe it was in March 1945, his only son was killed by the Allies during a raid. And so Webern was suffering horribly at this time. He had just lost his son. He was forcibly conscripted into providing military assistance during the Second World War at this time, so he couldn't live in his home. He was being billeted in various different places. He had absolutely no income whatsoever. His music was banned by the Nazis, and he had just absolutely no professional prospects at this point. So, and the most difficult thing of all, I think, is that shortly after Webern died, his music started to become internationally extremely significant, just hugely talked about and performed all over the world, and he just missed that. And so he had a life in which his compositions were derided, were not understood, they're very challenging pieces. There's no doubt about that, and especially at the time. I mean, for listeners who were unprepared for something that sounded like Webern's mature music, there's no question that it represented a challenge. But after he died, not long afterwards, his music became incredibly loved and significant and studied and talked about. And so, again, he just missed that. So this photograph shows a rather weary and exhausted and rather depressed figure at the end of his life. But it's also a photograph that, well, it's the last photo that was ever taken of Webern, as far as we know. And it approximately coincides with the period during which he was writing his Second Cantata. So the Second Cantata is Webern's last completed work. And Kurtág borrows from the final movement of Webern's final piece. So again, that sort of reinforces the funereal sort of requiem aspect of this piece, that he is in fact paying homage to the final completed music that Webern ever wrote. So the Second Cantata is one of Webern's most ambitious and lengthy pieces. and it is a secular cantata. But nevertheless, it is clearly informed by spirituality and by a sort of search for transcendence throughout. And the last movement of this cantata is an absolutely amazing thing. It's clearly inspired by Webern's obsession with Renaissance polyphony, with Renaissance vocal music, which he had studied as a doctoral student in Vienna in the early part of the 20th century. And it's got a very sort of strict contrapuntal outline to it. It's a double canon, so it's a work of tremendous technical sophistication, but it's also just really, really beautiful. So before we go any further, you need to hear this movement of Webern's second cantata, because Kurtág quotes it and he refers to it throughout the entire Officium Breve. I also have to talk about Andrzej Cervánski. So Cervánski, like Kurtág, is Hungarian, and like Webern and Kurtág, all three of them are composers from Central Europe. So Webern, for example, grew up in what was then Austria-Hungary, and of course after the First World War, that last remaining vestige of the Habsburg Empire was carved up into a series of small states, including modern-day Austria. And Hungary, of course, is a neighboring country. So all three of them are very closely related in that sense. Cervánski was very strongly influenced by Bartók in the earlier part of his career and wrote music in which the Balkan folk music aspect is very, very strongly present. But later on in his life, he discovered the music of Webern, and this was just an extraordinary shock for him, and his music starts to change after the early 1960s. And you can hear this very clearly in a work such as the Six Pieces for Orchestra, which sort of combine a Webernian terseness and a precision with an extraordinary beauty and sophistication of instrumental writing. So that's an absolutely amazing work that I would strongly encourage anyone to seek out. Generally speaking, though, Cervánski is not terribly well known outside of Hungary, so you can certainly be forgiven for not having heard of his music, but it's such beautiful music. So again, just if you can get your hands on anything by him, there's a lot of really good recordings of his music on YouTube that you can listen to. And Kurtág in the Officium Breve refers specifically to his work Serenade for String Orchestra. So that's a piece written in 1947 to 1948, and a very, very beautiful lyrical work for strings, and specifically to the third movement, the Arioso movement, which is a gorgeous accompanied melody. So we're going to listen to that in a second. I'll just quickly say that one of the main characteristics of this Arioso movement is that it's got a certain touching simplicity to it. So it's music that is strongly diatonic. In other words, it doesn't use a lot of chromatic or dissonant tones. It's also in C major, and that is very significant because, as we will see, the reference to C major and to the sort of fundamental tone of C is very prominent throughout the entire Officium Breve cycle. So really what we have in this piece is a triangulation of references and influences that are actually quite rich and complex between, on the one hand, Kurtág and Andrzej Cervánski and Webern. And so Webern influenced Stravinsky, who influenced Kurtág, who's also obsessed with Webern. You don't need to know all of that to appreciate this piece. You can certainly just listen to it for its surface qualities, which are remarkable on their own. But if you do sort of get a sense of where Kurtág's coming from and what his influences are and what the different materials are that he's drawing in to this piece, then I think you will appreciate it even more, and you'll get a sense of the incredible depth and richness that it's possible to pack into such a comparatively small duration. There's an incredibly complex web of references to all sorts of things in this piece, so I can't give you an exhaustive list because it would take a very long time to do that, but I just want to go over the work movement by movement and just talk about where some of the material comes from, because actually Kurtág composed very, very little work specifically for this quartet. In other words, a lot of the material is drawn on other sources. Beyond the references to Stravinsky and Webern, there's also a series of homages to colleagues and friends of Kurtág who had passed away. So these are all Hungarian musicians. So in the first movement, we have a very brief introduction. It's a solo cello movement, and it's in memory of the cellist Tibor Tuksányi. So I'm going to apologize for my pronunciation of these Hungarian words. I'll just do my best here. And the main reference here, again, is to Andrzej Stravinsky. And that comes through the use of very pure consonant intervals, such as perfect fifths, and also the reference to a fundamental tone of C. The second movement is similar in the sense that it also refers to Stravinsky through this use of the C fundamental, but this movement is also dedicated to the memory of recorder player Zsolt Baranyai. And this movement is interesting in that it refers to ancient church music through its use of notational symbols that are associated with medieval music. Again, another reference to the church, to a sort of idea of a service, and again, to the kind of funereal atmosphere of the music, generally speaking. The third movement is a duet for viola and cello, and it's a transcription of a piano piece that Kurtág had previously written for the series of piano duos Yatokok. So the main reference here, again, is to Stravinsky, and that comes through the use of falling intervals, which is very characteristic of the serenade for strings, and particularly the third movement. In the fourth movement, we have a series of highly chromatic clusters. There's an interesting mixture here. It still refers to Stravinsky, and we still have a very prominent fundamental tone of C major, but at the same time with a certain sort of Webernian chromatic edge to the music. So far, we're sort of in the sort of Stravinsky world, and the references to this composer are getting more and more concrete. In the fifth movement, we have an initial relatively explicit reference to Anton Webern. This is a fantasy using notes borrowed from the tone row of Webern's Opus 31 Cantata. The sixth movement is another reference to Webern. It is a canon. So that means that the different instrumental parts are all interrelated, but they're sort of imitating each other in a staggered way. So this is a technique that Webern used a great deal throughout his career, and specifically used in a very, very personal and sophisticated manner in the second cantata. So this is Kurtág explicitly rendering homage to that movement. The seventh movement is also a canon, and here we are getting towards something that is almost a literal quotation of Webern. So not only do we have the canon idea, but we also have the notes and the pitches that are associated with the second cantata. In the eighth movement, we have an homage in memory of another Hungarian musician. So this is Gabriela Garzó, who is a friend of the Kurtágs. And this movement quotes from Kurtág's piece, The Sayings of Pétre Bonamisza. And again, this is a movement that is strongly characterized by a sort of lamenting motif. So it's got these glissandos on a minor second. It's a sort of very haunting, mournful sound. And the following movement, then the ninth movement, develops this idea even further by using microtones. And we're going to have a look at that movement in greater detail towards the end of my analysis. But the reference here again is to Andrzej Stravinsky, generally speaking. In movement 10, we have for the first time essentially a literal quotation from Webern. So he's taking the last movement of the second cantata and he's quoting it and arranging it for string quartet. And this takes the form of a three-part structure, because the first part of movement 10 is a literal quotation. The middle part of this movement is a sort of adaptation. It's an arrangement of the canon, but it's a little bit different. And then in the last part, we have a repeat of the first part. So it's a three-part sort of ABA structure. and it's central, and it's one of the longer movements of the piece. So your sort of attention is focused onto this quotation of Webern. And so what's interesting here is that the references to these composers start off by being actually quite distant. They start off by being sort of very abstract allusions that you won't necessarily notice first off, but as we progress through the movements, we get towards quotations that are more and more literal until we do have an exact quotation of the piece. The 11th movement is in memory of Gheorghe Tsoltsiányi, and it is a transcription of a piano piece that Kurtág had written for him. He was a pianist. And here the reference is again to Stravinsky through the use of a C major pedal throughout the work. The 12th movement, finally, is a variation on movement 3, so and the movement that we had heard previously, which was a duet for viola and cello, except here he has expanded it into a piece for the full string quartet. In movement 13, we have another quotation from Kurtág's sayings of Peter Bonamisza, and the references here are threefold because we have Kurtág quoting his own music, we have references to Andrzej Stravinsky, and also to Webern. So the references are all sort of coming together at this point. And in the 14th movement, we reach the apex of complexity, of dissonance, of richness in the work. And here we have a clear reference to Hungarian folk music. It's got this kind of rugged sound to it. It sounds actually like it could be an extract from one of the Bartok quartets, like the fourth quartet, for example. And it's also got a kind of Webernian quality to it, this sort of dissonance to it, this complexity. Now, finally, in the 15th movement, we arrive at a literal quotation of Andrzej Stravinsky's Serenade for Strings. So next, I'd like to have a look at the 9th movement of this quartet, which I think is just such a beautiful little fragment of music. And it's just 4 bars long, and nevertheless, it manages to pack so much in. It's just such a beautifully meaningful little movement. So before we go on, I'd like to just have a listen to it, and we can also listen to it again a second time after I've sort of spoken a little bit about this movement. Basically, this texture has essentially two layers. So on the one hand, you have the two violins and the cello, and they're all playing in triple octaves. So it's a very, very widely spaced texture with the first violin in the very highest register, and the cello in the very lowest register, and the second violin in the middle. And these instruments are all sort of chromatically edging upwards from G upwards to a D, a perfect fifth above that. So this sort of chromatically sliding music covers a span of a perfect fifth. So that's obviously significant in the sense that it refers once again to the very open consonant intervals of the Stravinsky piece, but with the sort of chromaticism of Webern along with it. So this is a very, very slow movement. It's just this very slow, inexorable rising progression. And then the second element to the texture, the second layer, is that we have a solo viola. So the viola is set apart from the other instruments through a variety of means. The first one is that the violins and cello are playing with mutes, so their sound is going to be veiled, it won't be as prominent. And the viola is the only instrument in the quartet that is playing without a mute, so it's prominent for that reason. But it's also prominent in the sense that it's not playing these octaves along with the others, it's playing a solo passage that sort of moves chromatically and microtonally through this space. So not only do we have notes and pitches that don't belong to the octaves that are being played by the other instruments, but the viola is also playing with these tiny little microtonal inflections, sort of bending the notes slightly up or slightly down. And that sort of contributes to the sense of a lamentation, of a kind of mournful cry. The viola is also doing something very interesting here, which is that whereas the violins and the cello are sort of moving upwards in this inexorable rising movement, the viola has this downwards movement. So it's there's a very interesting sort of elementary contrary motion. That's a sort of very old contrapuntal technique. This idea of having one voice going up while at the same time the other voice goes down. And that's really what's happening here. So we have this beautiful, this sort of very expressive microtonal space on the one hand, that's provided by the viola, and we have this rising progression in the other strings. And Kurtág does this with such simple means. That's the thing that's so amazing about it. There's almost nothing in this movement, but it's so intense and it's so expressive. And one thing that I find absolutely remarkable is the way this movement ends. So we arrive ultimately up onto the high D in the strings here, but before we have everyone sort of arrive in unison on this D, which is the culmination of the movement of this piece, and the first violin edges up to an E flat, so it's just a semitone above the others, just a minor second above the others, and so we have this achingly beautiful sort of appoggiatura that has to be resolved. It's a little chromatic dissonance that he resolves downwards to the D, so that just before the end of the movement, everyone is playing a unison D at the end in octaves. It's absolutely beautiful. It's such a remarkable thing to have been able to pack such intense expressivity into only 4 bars of music. The seventh movement is interesting because here we are sort of teetering on the edge of a literal quotation from Webern, but it's not quite there yet. So it's certainly very strongly alluding to the Webern canon, and it's using the materials from this piece, but it's not yet a literal quotation. It's still an adaptation. It's still a relatively free arrangement of the piece. So what's so beautiful about this, I find, is that Kurtág is actually using one of Webern's favorite devices, which is the sort of so-called Klangfarben melody, the idea of a tone color melody, in which you have a series of tones in which the tone color and the timbre and the instrumental playing techniques are changing almost from note to note. Kurtág is taking a piece that stems from late Webern and applying this sort of technique to it of very, very subtle and sophisticated orchestration and different tone colors and changing playing techniques. He's applying this to that, and the result is really quite beautiful. So you can see here that he's got certain notes that are being played pizzicato, others are being played arco. You have harmonic notes suddenly coming in, and you've got all sorts of other indications, extremely subtle dynamic markings. You'll notice here that the music is sort of hovering between pianissimo and pianissimo writing, so it's just sort of barely on the edge of audibility, and that's another characteristic not only of Kurtág's music but also of Webern's. So let's have a listen to that. So I mentioned earlier that Kurtág proceeds through an interesting process of making his references and his quotations more and more direct progressively. And then, so what happens here is that in the very last movement of the work, he finally directly quotes Andrei Cervansky and the Arioso movement of the Serenade for Strings. So this is always, in Kurtág, a very, very important moment when suddenly a reference becomes a lot more explicit, and that's what happens in this work. So he saves it for the very, very end. And what's so remarkable about this is that by this point, we've heard this piece, we've heard 14 movements so far of a piece in which these homages, not only to Webern and to Cervansky, but also to this quartet of Hungarian musicians, is so thoroughly impregnated in the music that when he finally directly quotes Andrei Cervansky, it's as though the music has somehow become his own, and we don't even sort of notice so much that this is a direct quotation. It's so thoroughly embedded into the entire project of the piece. Nevertheless, this is really a direct quotation. Of course, it's an arrangement for string quartet, so it's the arrangement, the orchestration is a little bit different than the original Cervansky version, but this is as close as you can get to a literal quotation within the project of this piece. Kurtág doesn't just simply take this piece by Cervansky and sort of put it down in his piece. There's another aspect to what he's doing with it that is significant and that needs to be highlighted. He's framing it, okay? So he's taking this sort of object, and he's incorporating it into his own work, but he's framing it. He's not taking the whole thing. He's taking a specific portion of it and then cutting it off. And that simple act of displacement and of framing ultimately changes the way that you hear the piece, and it changes its meaning. Because what we have here is, as you can sort of see in the lower right-hand part of the screen, the piece just suddenly breaks off. It's just suddenly interrupted in mid-phrase. And that, of course, sort of exemplifies and intensifies the idea of a rupture, of forgetting, of a kind of memorial, mournful aspect to this piece. And it's very, very striking when this does happen. And it's just something that I think beautifully caps off the piece. So again, it's a remarkable work by Kurtág. Let's just have a quick listen now to the final movement.